We all know that it's a complex intra-articular fracture caused by three types of forces, mainly the varus valgus, axial and the rotational force. If you look at the incidence, you have most of the fractures being in isolated lateral condyle fractures, but you also have 10 to 20% medial condyle and bicondylar fractures in the upper end of tibia. Clinically, once you see this injury, the most important thing that you need to look at is the soft tissues and the neurovascular status, and then later on evaluate the fracture pattern. As far as x-rays are concerned, three x-rays are important: the AP, lateral, both obliques, and a 10 degree caudal view, which gives you the correct slope of the tibia. CT scan today has revolutionized the management of these fractures, and we have begun to understand more and more complex fracture patterns, especially the coronal splits, after the CT scan has come into existence. MRI is indicated in ligamentous injuries in select cases, but not really a good tool in acute injuries. So CT scan, especially taken with traction, is an important tool for planning management of these fractures besides x-rays. All of us are quite familiar with the Schatzker classification. You have the six types, the first four being partial articular and the next last two being complete articular bicondylar fractures with metafascial dissociation. The AO classification, where you have the A, B, C types, and commonly the C2 and C3 are corresponding to the Schatzker 5 and 6. Treatment principles: like anywhere else, the articular fracture needs to be anatomically reduced, whereas as far as the metadiaphyseal fracture is concerned, what you need to take into consideration is the length, axis and rotation. You need not go in for an exact anatomical reduction as far as the shaft is concerned. Point to note is you must repair the menisci primarily, and whatever you do, you must start early motion. Non-operative treatment is indicated in these situations. See that there is no varus, there is no condylar widening or an articular step, and this is how we treat them non-operatively: a cast for 3 weeks, then a brace, partial weight bearing at 6 weeks. But in all this process, if you see that the reduction is getting lost or if there is a varus tilt, then an intervention, surgical intervention, is required. Indications for surgery: the lateral condyle are these. I'm sure you can find these in any textbooks. What is more important is the tilt of the plateau and the condylar widening. The medial condyle, practically all displaced medial condylar fractures must be operated. Medial condyle does not tolerate displacement, and you could end up with a varus collapse either primarily or delayed, which is not a very good situation. Now, what will you do with this if I ask you, any of you? I'm sure all of you would go on to surgery. What I want to stress here is, first look at the soft tissues. Don't look at the x-ray. If this is the soft tissue, then you definitely cannot go in for an open reduction. Commonly used position is knee in flexion. We use this device called angle frame, which is a simple wooden device and allows you multiple varying degrees of knee flexion. It's also used for nailings of the tibia. Approaches: there are many approaches described. The minimally invasive for pure splits, fracture specific for unicondylar fractures. The most popular approach today is a double approach, which is anterior lateral and the posterior medial for bicondylar fractures. The Mercedes-Benz, which was used, that sign looks good on the cars but not on patients. If you go by the evidence published in JBJS A 2006 by David Barai, the dual incision technique seems to give much better results for C4 type of bicondylar fractures. So you have this dual incision, the anterior lateral sub meniscal visualization of the joint, and the posterior medial approach, which is reflecting the pes anserinus and preserving the lateral medial head of the gastrocnemius. So this is how you reflect the pes up, reflect the gastrocnemius down, and approach the posterior medial surface of the tibia. Let's see the fractures one by one. Partial articular fractures are from Schatzker type 1 to 4. Articular reduction can be done by either a direct visualization of the fracture — universal femoral distractor helps you in this — or an indirect reduction with the help of the C-arm. Stabilization can be done with single interfragmentary screws supplemented with a buttress plate or additional 3.5 millimeter screws. So Schatzker type 1, you can think of doing a percutaneous single screw fixation, or you could do a buttress plating in this. If you do a single screw fixation like this percutaneously, it should be supplemented with a cast. It is not stable enough to mobilize the knee with just one single screw. If you plate it, then of course you can start immediate mobilization. Type 2, a depressed fracture, split with depression, requires elevation, bone grafting and plating. So if it is a Schatzker 2, it is mandatory to elevate this and it is mandatory to buttress this. So this is how you need to elevate and supplement the defect with either a iliac crest bone graft or a bone substitute like this. And here a CT scan will give you the exact amount of depression. Another example looks quite good on X-ray, but if you see the CT, this is the kind of depression he had, and you had to elevate it and further supplement it with subchondral screws to maintain the articular reduction. Schatzker C3 is a pure depression, and this can be done with a percutaneous technique using fluoroscopy or an open technique using a metafascial window elevation and bone grafting like this. Whatever you do, you need to elevate that depressed articular surface and supplement it with a subchondral screw. An example here, see, the CT scan shows much better picture than the X-ray of the articular depression, and it has been elevated and supplemented with subchondral screws. Another example where this is done by a fluoroscopic technique only, elevation of the joint surface and supplementation with screws. Schatzker 4 are medial tibial plateau fractures. Though they look simple, they can be really dangerous because these are the ones who have a coronal split, which was not taken into consideration in the Schatzker classification. But since we are doing more and more CT scans, you can discernate them much better nowadays, and you see that they are frequently associated with a posterior medial fragment. These are the fractures which will require posterior medial buttressing, as I'll quickly show you. A word of caution, these fractures are also frequently associated with vascular injuries. So beware of the displaced medial plateau. Here again, a femoral distractor can be of immense help to reduce these fractures. See, this looks pretty innocuous, but then if you see the CT, this is the kind of the posterior medial comminution that you have, and this will require reduction and fixation using two plates, not just one. Bicondylar fractures, Schatzker type 5 and 6, require bicondylar stabilization. You could either do a double plate or a single locked plate, or external fixator, or an hybrid fixation. I'm going to quickly see each of these. A standard bicondylar fracture with a standard bicolumnar fixation, and this is the result at 3 months. Or if you're not happy with two plates because it involves extensive dissection and avascular necrosis of the condyles, a single lock plate on the lateral side is also sufficient. But then you must see that the medial plateau is not displaced. This is the evidence for it. Single lateral plate is not sufficient unless you have a polyaxial locking plate, because then you can actually catch that medial plateau well with multi-directional screws. Uniaxial lock plates may require additional medial screws, or better still, plated on the medial side and supplement with screws on the lateral side. Bicondylar plating with at least one lock plate is the best. Whatever you do, try and avoid this varus because it's just waiting to fail. Schatzker 6, best evidence supports two incision technique, provided your soft tissues allow. And while doing this, first tackle the medial condyle. So you first reduce the medial condyle and build the lateral condyle onto the posterior medial condyle, which you have already fixed. So start with a posterior medial approach, reflect the PES, build up the posterior medial condyle, buttress it with whatever plate available to you. The best plate that we have found is a T plate, but any plate would do. Even a 3.5 screws are sufficient enough, and then build up your anterolateral condyle over it by a separate incision like this. Okay, so beware of this posterior medial fragment. Now this is what you need to identify and buttress It requires a posterior medial buttress. A simple T-plate does the job. Another example. I'm about to finish. Another example here where a T-plate has been used to buttress the posterior medial coronal split. External fixation is good if your soft tissues do not allow internal fixation, but it should be used as a temporary device. This was concluded by the Canadian Orthopedic and Trauma Society after a multicentral RCT published in JBJS A 2006. Hybrid fixation, there is no difference in time to union, and internal fixation is much better in all these respects. Arthroscopic assisted is good for pure depressions but has a long learning curve and it can cause compartment syndromes, iatrogenic. Outcomes. Paul Tornatuck nicely summarized the outcomes of apparent tibial fractures. Worst outcomes are associated with all these situations. So poor articular reduction, inadequate fixation, varus is the most important thing that you need to look at. And if you do not repair the menisci. Recent advances, instead of autogenous bone grafts, you could use bone substitutes. Resorbable tricalcium phosphate is the best. Bioglass has also shown promising results. A LIS technique is being developed for apparent TBIs, and polyaxial locking plates are already there in the market. So you could use any of these. So to summarize, see whether the fracture is only in a sagittal plane or a coronal plane or both. If it's only in the sagittal plane, a single plate would do your job. But if it's a coronally split fracture, you must use two plates, either the posterior medial or the posterior lateral. Repair the meniscus and prevent varus. Thank you.